If you're joining us for the first time, this is the Apologetics Academy, which I run every Saturday at 8 p.m. UK time, which corresponds to 3 p.m. Eastern, 2 p.m. Central, or 12 noon Pacific. And each week we bring in different scholars, experts, theologians, speakers to talk about subjects of interest to Christians, particularly pertaining to Christian apologetics and the question of whether Christianity is in fact true. We also cross-examine and evaluate other worldviews, such as Islam and Mormonism and so forth. And we also bring in often non-Christian scholars and speakers to critique, to present their critiques of Christianity. And then we ask them questions and see how well these counter-arguments against the Christian faith really stand up. This week we have with us Nick Peters, whom I will introduce in a second, who's going to be talking to us about the resurrection of Jesus from an honor shame perspective. The following week, on September 10th, we have Sir Anthony Buzzard, who is a very well-known biblical Unitarian, and he's going to talk to us about why I am a biblical Unitarian. So he's going to argue against the deity of Christ and against the Trinity, and we will be having a conversation with him about his views in that regard. And then the following week, we will have Lynn Wilder on with us, who is an expert on Mormonism. She is a former Mormon herself, and she is going to be talking to us about sharing the gospel with Mormons. So we look forward to hearing that as well. That will be on September 17th. And the week after that, we have Alan Hainlein on with us from Dallas, Texas, who will be talking to us about the cosmic fine-tuning argument. Alan Hainlein is a real expert on the fine-tuning argument, and so he's going to be talking to us about that and how we can use the fine-tuning argument as one strand of evidence in support of theism. There's a number of ways that you can participate in these webinars. You can simply sit and watch anonymously and enjoy the show if you wish. There's also a chat window that you can participate in, and you can see that people have been already participating in the chat window. You can also submit questions anonymously by hitting the Q&A button and typing in a question, and then I will read that to our guest speaker and he will address your question. Or you can raise your hand and there's a raise your hand button at the bottom of your screen as well, and I will promote you to be a co-panelist with Nick, our speaker tonight, and you will have an opportunity to dialogue with him and raise your comments, questions, concerns, criticisms, points of clarification, whatever, and dialogue with him by engaging your webcam and microphone. So as I mentioned, this evening we have with us Nick Peters, who's going to be talking to us about the resurrection. And Nick Peters, of course, is the son-in-law of Dr. Michael Lacuna, who's been on our webinar before. And Nick Peters is going to be talking to us about the resurrection from an honor shame perspective. He runs a ministry called Deeper Waters, Nick, do you want to maybe just tell us a bit about your ministry, Deeper Waters, and just provide a little bit of background to yourself for those that maybe haven't come across your work before?
Yeah, first up, I'd like to thank you for having me on. And in case anyone has been wondering, this has been asked to me before. Yes, I was doing apologetics long before I came across Mike Lacuna. So, but I just put in the link to my website now. You all can hear me, okay? Right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. I just put in the link to my website, deeperwaters.ddns.net. And Deeper Waters is a ministry with a number of themes and purposes to it. I've been doing the blog since 2007, so we're almost up to 10 years of this ministry. And I, just a few years ago, started doing a podcast. And if you're listening to Jonathan's show live, or you're listening to my show live, or you can't do that anymore, but if you were, you'd have to be missing one of us, because we record at the same time. Unfortunately, I can't join into Jonathan's seminars that often. But I generally record from 3 to 5 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, and I have a number of scholars that come on my show as well, and we talk about books they've released and such. You talk about Lynn Wilder. She's been on my show before, wonderful lady. And, of course, Mike Lacuna's been on a few times. And where our ministry has a number of themes. Naturally, we are an apologetics ministry. Second, one of the themes I want to concentrate on a lot of times is discipleship. I think too often in the Christian church, we talk about getting conversions. I'm not interested in converts. I'm interested in disciples. Talking about conversions is kind of like getting someone to the altar, having them say, I do, and not giving them any marriage help from then on. No, I'm interested in getting people who will be disciples of Christ. Then we're a marriage-minded ministry. You see, before I got married, I was very much pro-marriage, pro-traditional marriage, everything like that. Now I'm married, I'm pro-marriage. So it's not only about defending traditional marriage, but it's also about good marriage enrichment. We've had guests come on like, say, Martin and Kay Yorkovich talking about their book, How We Love, all about building up marriage. And then finally, and this is something I think you can relate to, Jonathan, I think we've talked about this some before, we're a disabilities awareness ministry, but particularly on the autism spectrum. My wife and I both have Asperger's. Recently, I got to fill in for William Lane Craig's Defenders class doing a lesson I do called Is the Disabled My Neighbor? And making sure that the church has awareness of disabilities, particularly mental issues, and then particularly in that, Asperger's. So that's about all there is to say about us. I can say on my end, I'm going to turn 36 this year. My wife turned, my wife turned 26 last month. So yes, I robbed that crater big time. And if I'm not reading, I usually enjoy playing a game, a classic video game, usually Zelda or Final Fantasy, some of them playing game most of the time, or even word games and such, watching some good TV shows, things of that sort. But I spend a lot of my time reading. So anything else anybody wants to know?
That's great. Thank you, Nick. Do you want to maybe just kick off into your presentation on the resurrection then, and we'll take it from there?
Yeah. Well, I mean, one of the things that I'm going to be doing is, I mean, Mike's been on talking about the resurrection before, I take it, right?
Say again?
Mike Lacona's been on talking about the resurrection.
Mike Lacona has been on talking about gospel differences. He's scheduled to talk about the resurrection as well.
Okay. Well, if anyone's familiar with the minimal facts approach of Gary Habermas and Michael Cohen, I'm going to be assuming all of that for the sake of argument. I mean, if you want to use that, that's fine. I use it too, but this is something I want to consider kind of an add-in bonus to the minimal facts approach. And that's the honor shame perspective. One of the mistakes we make in reading the Bible and studying of our cultures, we can even make this mistake if we talk about ISIS today, is here in the West, we tend to presume that every single culture is just like ours. And people have always fought just the same way we do. And really, they haven't. Scholars who have studied the culture of the past and studied this in many cultures today have noted their differences. For instance, here in America, when Hurricane Katrina hit, you had looters going all throughout New Orleans, stealing everything they could constantly. Meanwhile, when a tsunami hits Japan, people tend to go outside with their doors unlocked and wait in line patiently, and no one steals normally from anyone else. I mean, there could have been a few exceptions and such. For the most part, it's not a concern. Why? Because it would be dishonorable to steal from someone in this situation. You would bring shame on your family. Japanese culture is really fascinating to look at in this regard. And my wife loves Japanese culture. You talk about things like Dragon Ball or anime or Pokemon, things like that. Oh yeah, she loves it all. And if I'm watching this before, I can talk about, hey, well, honey, you know, this is the way the Japanese culture is. And she knows it too. We see honor and shame showing up. But honor and shame are pretty much talking about how your reputation is among the people that you're with. We today in the West tend to think in terms of individualism, where it's this idea of do your own thing, be your own man. We have self-esteem. Realize the value you have in yourself. Who cares what other people have to say about you? Establish your own identity. In the ancient world, that would not have made much sense. In fact, it would have been seen as deviant. Because in the ancient world, the biblical world, Mediterranean culture and such, your identity came from the people around you and what they thought of you. Now, to an extent, we do have this today, because I don't think you can entirely escape honor and shame. We just don't emphasize as much as we should. If anyone here is on Facebook, for instance, Facebook is actually an interesting way to consider honor or shame, because people like to have likes. They want to have their posts shared. I mean, how many businesses do you see having advertisements of like us on Facebook? And if you have so many likes, well, you probably have a good reputation. And if you have so many friends, well, you probably have a good reputation as well. Reputation still means a lot to people. We can't entirely escape it. In case anyone's wondering where that illustration comes from, actually, it comes from Jackson Wu, who is a scholar in the Far East of Chinese descent. And I heard him talk about it at a ETS, and he gave the same sort of analogy, I believe, on my own show when we talk about honor and shame. But your honor was everything. It meant more to you than paying our bills does to us today. If you were entirely shamed, it could even lead to suicide in that case. And so when we read the New Testament, when Jesus is going around interacting with the Pharisees and everyone else, it is interacting for honor. Jesus is trying to build up his honor reputation, and the Pharisees are trying to shame him. Now, some of us might be tempted to think, well, isn't that a bad thing to want honor and such? Well, when you read Romans 2, Paul talks about those who seek honor, glory, and immortality. He doesn't seem to have a problem with it. It's as if we should seek these things. And when Jesus talks about going to a party, he says, don't sit at the most important seat, because if you do, your host might come to you and say that this seat has been reserved for someone else. Please take a lower seat, and you will be shamed in front of a company. But when you go sit the lowest position, then when your host comes, he'll say, friend, move up to a better place, and you will be honored in the sight of all. So it's not, there's nothing wrong with seeking honor per se. Now, of course, you can seek honor selfishly, and such there can be wrong ways to seek honor, but honor itself isn't a bad thing. And part of our Christian vocation, in fact, is to give honor and glory to God. In fact, if you're interacting with Muslims, this is something I think they understand very well. Why is it that Jesus wasn't crucified? I think one of the reasons they say is because this would be shameful. And in a sense, they're absolutely right. I mean, they're not absolutely right that Jesus wasn't crucified. Of course he was. But they are definitely right that that is something shameful. When Jesus is challenged by the Pharisees, what we have going on is what's called challenge riposte. And in this case, a Pharisee comes up to Jesus and asks him a question. Now, in the ancient world there, if you asked a question publicly or even gave a compliment publicly, the goal wasn't learning. The goal was instead trapping. When the rich young ruler comes up to Jesus and says, good teacher, what must I do to inherit eternal life? It's a compliment given to Jesus, which is also a trap. Because if Jesus responds the way the rich young ruler wants, then Jesus will incur a sort of social debt to the rich young ruler. Instead, Jesus turns the question and the compliment over to God and says, "Why do you call me good? No one is good but God alone," which is also, in a way, Jesus looking at him saying, "Okay, you want to say I'm good? Well, no one is good but God alone. If you still want to call me good, are you willing to accept that level of devotion?" He doesn't deny it, but he wants to, in an essence, see how far the rich young ruler is willing to go. Now, when a question is asked, it's an attempt to shame the person speaking, as if to say, "Hey, can you answer this question or not?" It's amusing. We often get it wrong about, we think Nicodemus was a figure who was ashamed because he went to Jesus by night privately. When in fact, if you truly wanted to learn something from someone, you would go privately. Nicodemus is in fact acting the most honorable way of all, out of all the opponents Jesus had. So that, which is not a surprise when you get to the end of John's gospel and Nicodemus is in a very good light wanting to bury Jesus. Now, a number of other aspects could influence your honor rating, some you had no control over. How you were born had something to do with it. When Paul starts talking about being a Jew from Tarsus, when he mentions Tarsus, he's not just filling out a biography and answering trivia. What he's doing is saying, "I'm from Tarsus. Tarsus is a city of good reputation. Therefore, I should be treated seriously." Jesus instead comes from Nazareth, to which Nathanael says, "Can anything good come out of Nazareth?" Nazareth would be seen as a shameful locale to come from, which is somehow lends credibility to the accounts. If we were making up the story of Jesus, we would not have him come from Nazareth. We would have him come from much more well-to-do cities like Sepphoris or Jerusalem, some city that would be held in high honor, but not Nazareth. His parents were poor people. Sure, they were good, abiding Jews, but they were poor. These are not the kind of people you would make up. When we look even more at Jesus, you know, a lot of times skeptics will talk about Jesus saying, "Why weren't more people writing more about Jesus? This was the Son of God going around." Well, there are a number of reasons. Jesus would not have ranked high on their radar. If you're an educated person in Rome, you're not going to care about a Jewish rabbi who's never written a book, didn't establish a school, never went outside of his country, save if we believe the account in Matthew, which I do. Rather, he went to Egypt as a child. You would never go to him because he never went to battle. He never ran for office. And oh yeah, he was crucified. I can't explain how serious crucifixion would be to these people. Going and saying Jesus was crucified would be like saying that you were a candidate running for political office and you were a convicted pedophile as well. It would be one of the worst things you could do. Cicero, for instance, said that crucifixion is something we don't even talk about. John the Baptist, he died by beheading, which was a more honorable way to die. Now, of course, most of us would still prefer to not die that way, but it was an honorable way to die. It was reserved for Roman citizens many times as well. But crucifixion, it wasn't designed just to kill. It was designed to shame. And a person was made to be an object lesson to everyone else around, saying, "Hey, don't be like this guy." So you go up to a Jew and start talking about Jesus, and you get to the crucifixion, and the Jew goes, "Let me stop you right there. We're done here." Because no Messiah would be crucified, because a person who is crucified is under the curse of God. You go to a Greek, you start talking about Jesus, and then you get to the crucifixion. He says, hold on, let me get this straight. You're talking about your king, and your king was crucified. Kings don't get crucified. It makes no sense whatsoever to them. And they're right. This is how contrary the gospel is. It goes against everything we would expect. In fact, as I'm going to be arguing here, if you were living in a time and you were wanting to write something on how to make a religion that would be extremely successful, Christianity would be a textbook example of what you would not make. Everything about Christianity, really, was shameful. So let's start going through some more of it, okay? One aspect that was taught about in Christianity a lot was the virgin birth, which we're always wondering, I do indeed affirm the virgin birth. Some of you understand that joke series going on. But a lot of people would say, well, this is something that should have been talked about a lot. Well, no. The virgin birth, in fact, would be something the gospel writers would often want to avoid talking about, because it would lend charges to Jesus being born illegitimately, and what Messiah would be born illegitimate. And in fact, it could maybe paint some people to think, Jesus sounds too much like the pagan myths. Now, I don't think Christianity copied from the pagans at all, but they might have wanted to avoid any sort of idea whatsoever. I would contend, in fact, the main reason they wrote about the virgin birth is they had to. There was enough talk going on about Jesus and his conception and something odd about it, and they said, well, you might not believe it, but here's what happened. You know, beyond crucifixion, what else was there? Jesus was resurrected. When he was resurrected, that's something shameful to the people. Resurrection to us today sounds really good. When you read a work like John Dominic Crossan and Reed's book on Paul, what they say is it would have been like returning to the shackles of prison. When Socrates is put to death, he's asked for a cock to be given to the god of healing. Why? Because Socrates is being delivered from his body. And this is a good thing. The body was a prison you wanted to escape. And we're finding this more and more when we look at ancient history. It was Anderson's monograph that he wrote, but God raised him from the dead, looking at the resurrection in Luke Acts, where we count some people on the other side meeting someone and asking if he'd like something, which wouldn't be rather good for him. And then implies, I'd sooner be living again. To return to life would be a very bad thing for these people. And yet, this is what Christianity taught. Now, you can understand it some with the Jews, because the Jews would have said, and well, yeah, we believe in a resurrection, because a resurrection will happen at the end of time. God's going to raise us. The Sadducees would be an exception. The resurrection would happen at the end. But going out to the Gentiles, this would not be a bad thing, a good thing. If we were seeing this change going on with Christianity changing to meet the Gentiles and get them in, we would expect to see moving away from resurrection language more towards Gnosticism and such. Gnosticism would have made sense to the people of the time, because surely God would not associate with matter in this way. And yet Christianity never budged on this. They held to resurrection. They held to the goodness of the body. They held to an incarnational theology. Today, we tend to take that all for granted, but in the world of the Mediterranean, that would have been utterly shocking. Now, something else, Christianity was a new religion. You see, when a belief was new, it was to be viewed with suspicion. Because if anyone knew the way of the gods, it would have been the ancients, because they were closer to the times of creation or had the knowledge from far back in the past. And if the gods had revealed themselves to the ancients, then we shouldn't expect anything new. We want the old stuff. Novelty was viewed with suspicion. But Christianity was new. This is why the church fathers often tried to say, what we're talking about is neither new nor strange. So this is the religion of Moses, of the prophets. Why would they do something like that? Because they're trying to establish their belief is old. Of course, the revelation of Jesus was new, but they're saying, hey, what we talk about is rooted in ancient beliefs. So that's just the point. Newness was viewed with suspicion, and yet Christianity was new. There was a time when Christians could have identified themselves with Judaism to outsiders, but as soon as events like 70 AD came along with a temple being destroyed, that went out the window because it was clear then that Christians were different. We start seeing this in the Nevonian persecution when Christians are seen as a separate group, and there's no doubt that Jews were more than happy to out the Christians at the time, who were seen as shameful, especially teaching the Messiah that they did. Now, also in the ancient world, tolerance was a virtue that was often practiced, but in many cases like today, tolerance was done as long as you were willing to agree with what the people in charge were saying. See, the Jewish religion, for instance, the Jews at the time did not worship the emperor. Now, this was odd to the Romans, but the Romans were willing to let it slide because the Jews were an ancient people with an ancient heritage. All they had to do was be willing to pray for the emperor, perhaps offer sacrifices on his behalf. But the Christians didn't have this luxury. And the Christians were much more in your face out there being evangelistic. When we read statements about how Jesus is one that every knee will bow, every tongue confess that he's Lord, anytime we read about Jesus being the Lord, Romans 10:9 and 10:14, for instance, that's a direct challenge to Caesar, and would have been seen as such. You could not say Jesus is Lord, and oh, by the way, Caesar is too. I mean, you could recognize the emperor as the emperor, but you sure couldn't recognize him as a deity. Now, had the early Christians wanted to get the acceptance like that, they could have said, oh, well, here's Jesus, and we're going to include him in the pantheon of other gods. You can worship him alongside Jupiter or Mithras or Dionysus or any other deity you want. But they didn't. They said, Jesus is Lord alone. God has revealed himself in Jesus. There are no other gods. There is only our Trinity, which, of course, the four outworking of Trinity came along later, but the belief, the seeds were all right there. This would have incurred the wrath of the Romans at this point. In fact, it's something to point out, this would have been shameful for Christians trying to live out their daily lives. I recently on my show interviewed Larry Hurtado. He has a book coming out this month. I got to read an advanced copy of it called Destroyer of the Gods. Now, his book isn't an apologetics book. Now, he does come from a Christian perspective, but it's a book about how Christianity was distinct from other religions of a time. And one of the ways it was in this treatment of the gods. Usually if you went to visit a friend, for instance, you go into their house, you pay tribute to their gods, and then you'd have your meeting, whatever. Christians couldn't do that. And that would have made them social outcasts and pariahs for the community. It would have been seen as beyond rude to go into someone's house where you were a guest and not acknowledge the gods. And this is one reason we have such a talk about meat offered to idols. And how do you deal with the gods in this way? Now, what happens when you're shamed? Is it just that everyone sits around, they don't want to play with you anymore, and they send you off to a corner? Well, sometimes they do. But sometimes it's worse. When disasters would strike, like floods or wars or famine or something else, then what would happen is that the people would gather and say, okay, the gods have not been honored properly. We must do something here. We must find out why. Oh, look, Christians over here. Christians are not honoring the gods. Christians are being deviant. Okay, let's go ahead and throw them to the lions, kill them, whatever kind of punishment needs to be inflicted. And then the gods will be pleased and society can get back to normal. Because Christians were the deviants in this. Christians were ones that were disrupting the social order entirely. Now, some people might say, well, yeah, but Christians were gaining honor among themselves and such. Perhaps. But would you ever go the honor of the minority or the honor of the majority? Another aspect that would have been seen as problematic is that Christians talked about Jesus doing miracles. Miracles were something that a lot of people were skeptical about. Lucian, for instance, prided himself on pointing out people who were hoaxes and such doing miracles. If you want to see how it would have been seen today, think of the way televangelists like Benny Hinn and others were seen in the past, or are seen today. That could be the way Jesus was seen in the past. He could have been seen as if he was a huckster of sorts. So again, Christianity is a shameful belief. So now when we look at all the ways that Christianity was shameful, we have to ask, okay, why did it survive? Now, I contend Christianity survived and overcame the social stigmas against it because it was true. People could not deny the resurrection had taken place. And this is something interesting because the people who had the most honor to lose were ones who were middle and upper class. And so when someone would come to them and talk to them about Christianity, they would be the ones who have the most means to investigate the claims. And so they would go and send a servant, for instance, who would investigate and talk to people who claim to be eyewitnesses, a sort of fact-finding mission, and then come back, and these people would become Christians. Now, this is interesting. These people had the most honor to lose, and yet they have the most means to check the claims, and they often became Christians. But early church did consist of several middle and upper class Christians. We read about several of them in the New Testament. Now, someone could say, well, maybe the poor would want to join in. Well, not really, because Christianity made clear that Jesus was crucified, and that shaming message wasn't just for the elite. In fact, it was mainly for the poor. It was an object lesson to the poor. Don't be like this person. The poor would want to hold on to whatever honor they had, and joining Christianity would make them lose even that honor. We could also have someone could say, well, okay, Christianity survived. What about Islam? Islam survived. Islam could be seen as a religion in that sense if it wasn't for one difference. Islam spread a lot by the sword. Christianity didn't, at least until it became an established religion at the time of Constantine and such. My contention is Christianity should have never even made it to Constantine. It should have died out quickly. The only reason it didn't was true. But how about modern Mormonism today? We have a difference there is Mormonism grew up in a society that was more live and let live. Where if you're going to believe something strange, okay, but a lot of people wouldn't say, we'll just let you do your own thing. Individualism was much more rampant. Now, of course, Mormons were persecuted some, but here's another difference. Mormons had wide open spaces they could go to throughout the country. In fact, going so far as going all the way out west where they could be by themselves. Christians would have to retreat to the catacombs. Any mimic would have been easily tracked down. And Mormonism did go in a society where the new was much more welcome. People were eager for new ideas and such. Now, that's just a bit of a basic look at how this was done. Jonathan, do you want me to answer some of the questions that I see popping up in the chat, or what?
You can do it if you want, or you can finish your presentation, then we can take questions. Are you finished what you're wanting to say?
I think I've said enough. I mean, just lay down the bare basics of what it is, and we can go from there to discussing it. I mean, the main point is Christianity was a shame for religion, and the only reason it survived was because it was true. By the resurrection, it would have been God vindicating Jesus' claims and saying Jesus is who he said he was, restoring the honor of Jesus. So let me look here and see what some people have said. We're talking about the virgin birth, that Mark didn't mention it. Yes, I agree. Mark didn't mention the virgin birth. And I think Mark didn't because, one thing, he wouldn't have wanted to. And second, because it's my contention, Mark is the testimony of Peter. And so I think these were events that Peter knew about in his own lifetime, and he could have witnessed in his own lifetime. I think Richard Barker makes a very good argument that it's an inclusio account. I mean, you have a statement of Papias. So yeah, I think that's in there. And by the time we get to Matthew or Luke, people are asking questions about Jesus' heritage. And so we say, yeah, okay, we're going to explain this here. Yeah, see, Islam would only be considered a shame from a highly dualistic perspective, not from a Jewish perspective, saw the physical universe as God's good creation. Okay, yeah, I think that's about Islam, except I don't remember saying Islam was shameful. I said Islam would have seen the crucifixion of Jesus as shameful, and I agree. And when you say Christ redeemed us from the curse of the law, Galatians 3:13, yes, that's the point of a crucifixion, but from the perspective of people of time, it was indeed something shameful. See, Trinity was not revealed later. Well, when I say Trinity was not revealed later, what I mean is people at the time of Jesus weren't going around quoting the Nicene Creed and such. When you see the church fathers, you see the Trinity doctrine being developed, as it were. People are trying to understand what it means to have a Father, Son, and Spirit being one God in three persons, and we're trying to work it out. That's something that we see naturally developed. No one ever spoke like this man about being him. I agree. But what I'm also talking about is that people in the Roman culture at the time, all the way in Rome, if they heard these stories about miracles, they would have said, this is just some sort of huckster and such. Joseph Smith was shot to death. Yes, note that I said some people live and let live. Not all were. The Mormons could still flee if they wanted to. And yes, Joseph Smith did die in a shootout. And yes, he was shooting back for people who try and claim he had died an innocent martyr. Such. Okay, how did they justify crucifying him? Okay, if you're asking how they justified crucifying Jesus, it was Jesus was guilty of blasphemy. Mainly. And they wanted to send that to the Romans. And so Romans would not care about a blasphemy charge at all. Pilate would just say, okay, blasphemy, yeah, stone him. That wasn't good enough for the Jews at the time who wanted to make an object lesson of Jesus. So they said, he's also claiming to be the Messiah. That's claiming to be the king. And I think that very well was part of the trial going on. Bart Ehrman actually has come up with an interesting idea about what Judas told the high priest at the time was that in private, Jesus was saying he was the Messiah. Now, I disagree with Bart Ehrman on a whole lot, but I think that's an interesting idea that could be considered. And so when Pilate hears charges that Jesus is claiming to be the king, then the Jews put him on a spot and say, you know what, if you want to be in good terms with Caesar, you don't want to allow another king. And I believe Pilate's main mentor guy, Sejanus, had just been brought up on charges of treason in Rome. And so Pilate could have been on thin ice at this point, saying, yeah, I want to show myself I'm favorable towards Rome, so I'll go for crucifixion.
We have a hand that was raised by Garrett, folks. And by the way, if you have a question for Nick, then raise your hand and I will promote you to be a co-panelist with Nick and interact with him. And also, if you want to, if you prefer to submit questions anonymously, you can do so by hitting the Q&A button at the bottom of your screen. Hey, Garrett, you're on live with Nick Peters.
Hi, Garrett.
Hey, can you hear me?
We can hear you.
Hey, Nick.
Hey.
Hey, Jonathan.
Hey, do you have a webcam, Garrett?
I do, but I can try to get it to work. Yeah, let's give it a try.
Yeah, for all wondering, no, I don't have a webcam, unfortunately.
Yeah. I've seen Garrett before use a webcam, so I was just wondering.
Okay. Let's see.
There you are.
Okay. Hi there.
Oh, we can't hear you anymore, Garrett.
Yeah, I can't hear you now.
Can you hear me now?
Yes, we can. Go ahead.
Does it sound okay?
Yes, it sounds great.
Okay, cool. Okay. I play Star Wars Battlefront with my cousin on this setup, and if I have both cameras going, it sounds funny for him, but if this sounds good, then okay, cool.
Okay.
So I think there's a little bit more that needs to be fleshed out. You know, so I think a big point about Christianity is that it attracted outsiders. You know, counterculturalists, if you would, the people who weren't accepted in the mainstream. And so, you know, I think a big component that you need to consider when you're considering the formation and the path that early Christianity took is that the people that became Christians may not have, you know, really ran in the circles that, you know, this that the normal social standards would have applied to. So, you know, you may have had people who didn't have, you know, much of a social, much attachment to the social surroundings anyway, because they were outcasts. They were people on the outside. And you do tend to see just sociologically that that's the kind of people that tend to convert to other religions, is the people that are on the fringes of that social group, so to speak. And I mean, you know, with sociology, I mean, Scientology, you know, you see rich people convert to that crazy religion. And that's obviously a very shameful religion because they believe in aliens. And you know, I think you made a good fair point about Mormonism, but I do also think that, you know, we should look to Mormonism as a group that, you know, was on the outliers. It was a group that formed, like Christianity, of outcasts, and then, you know, became, you know, we had a presidential candidate a couple of years ago from Mormonism. So, yeah.
Okay. I'm going to, you want to stay on to me interact with you some?
Yeah, absolutely.
Okay. You're talking about people in the ancient world who would not have pretty much fallen into the whole honor shame mindset. Is that correct?
Yeah.
Do you have any examples in mind?
Well, I mean, you know, so when you look at Christianity, you see that, you know, the early Christians, they were very eccentric. They spoke in tongues. In 1 Corinthians, he talks about them seeming mad to people coming in to watch them.
Right.
And we know that speaking in tongues was something that was not unique to Christians. It was, of course, done by all the groups that practiced ecstatic worship, including the Dionysus cults, and tons of other religions, including some Jewish cults. Mm-hmm. You know, and you might even point out that some Jews, I don't believe it's the Essenes, but, you know, there were Jews that believed that there could be a second deity of sorts, the second god, I think it's Margaret Baker, I can't remember her name, but the author of, you know, the second, Israel's second god, I think that's the name of the book. Anyway, Philo, another Jew who had beliefs that were very not mainstream. You know, he believed that Moses was the incarnation of God, the Logos. Mm-hmm. And then, you know, there are tons. The Book of Enoch, very popular book in Jesus's day, a book that promotes Enoch as a sort of God-man, possibly even, depending on what scholar you ask, possibly even the Son of Man himself. So there were tons of kind of countercultural groups in the Jewish milieu that, you know, would have been attracted to Jesus, would have seen him as somebody offering something. And who, you know, even after his death, there would have been people that would have heard about him in the Jewish milieu that would have been interested. And then the Roman milieu is more tolerant, you know, but again, you know, I do think that you have to think about who it is that Christianity is bringing in. It's not people that are necessarily mainstreamists. You know, there's lots of, you know, there's lots of bleed over, just like in our culture today.
Okay, but what I'm wondering is, I mean, you talk about people like the Essenes and such, but I didn't hear any evidence that anyone did not believe in the honor or shame paradigm. They might believe different things were honorable and different things were shameful, but they still held the honor and shame.
Oh, right. I'm not necessarily challenging that. I'm just suggesting that some people would have not cared about what society at large would have thought so much as other people.
Okay, but what I'm wondering is, who are these people exactly?
I mean, you know, in every society, there's always people, counterculturalists, there's always the hippies, there's always the outcasts, the people who don't fit in, don't go with the flow. And that seems to be who Jesus attracted and who were attracted to Jesus even after his death.
Okay, I can't. Well, then, can you tell me these specific people, since you seem to know that these were people who were attracted? So,
I gave some examples. Paul is obviously very familiar with the Stoics, and Philo was is one of the most important ancient writers that we have for the time, and was a Jew who was also Stoic. And, you know, those beliefs don't necessarily go together, because Stoicism is a kind of a Greek Buddhism almost, and Judaism is a very different kind of belief than the Greeks held. And he was a Jew that blended those together. He promoted the concept of the Logos as God's firstborn son, firstborn creation, and the force through whom God would have created the universe. He believed it was Moses, which is obviously very not mainstream belief. We also know that, as Bart Ehrman points out in his last book, that there were Jews that worshipped angels and believed that angels could be lesser or greater manifestations of God and so deserved to be worshipped. And we know that the Jewish Second Temple authorities had to announce proclamations prohibiting the worship of angels, which implies that that was something that people were doing. And, you know, and then I'm trying to remember, is it the Essenes? My mind's drawing a blank right now. That were the group from whom we have the desert scrolls, the lost.
That's the major scholarly opinion. I'd agree to that. But, you know, you've said a lot right here, so I hope you don't mind if I just come in and start responding.
Absolutely.
One thing, Philo and Paul in their times would not have been seen as outcast. Philo was still very much respected, and Paul would not have been seen as an outcast until he became a Christian. So embracing Christianity was what led him to be an outcast of sorts. And I'm still waiting to hear who these specific people were who were outcast. And even if they were, the last thing they would do is join another religion where they would be even more outcast. They would seek something very honorable. And as for the Enochian beliefs and such, I think you'll find a lot of things that Bart Ehrman talks about, well, he says a lot of them are mainstream, they're not really as mainstream. There is a release out the same time from, I assume you're talking about the book How God Became Jesus, right?
Yeah.
Okay, but that's actually not his latest one. He's come out now with Jesus Before the Gospels. But
it
was released about how Jesus became God, and Michael Burry books a lot of literature. But one other book that I think has been released since then, it's got one of the most fascinating hypotheses in it, is Chris Tilling's book, Paul's Divine Christology, where he looks at the way beings are seen as, not necessarily God, but beings could be seen as divine in the literature. He says, what sets Yahweh apart is his relationship with Israel, his covenant relationship. No other being have a kind of covenant relationship. And then when we get to the New Testament, what makes it fascinating is Christ has that exact same parallel relationship with the people of God, the church. So what I'm ultimately saying is that I just don't see these outcasts that you're talking about. Richard Carrier talks about this kind of thing. He says that where, sure, there would be outcasts out there who would join the religion and such. Where, who were they? He doesn't give us, he just points to some vague group, doesn't define them, doesn't give evidence of their existence, just says, well, they had to be there. Well, I'm not convinced, especially in an honor shame society where even the lowest of the low still cared about honor.
Well, I mean, what are you really pointing out that is so dishonorable about Christianity other than the fact that Jesus is an ironically martyred martyr and that, you know, people don't eat food sacrificed to idols sometimes, which, you know, Paul says it doesn't really matter where the food comes from. Just do it anyway. Just eat it. It doesn't matter if it's going to offend somebody, just eat it. So that I don't really see that would have been an issue for Paul. And I mean, like, again, you know, like Rodney Stark points out in his book about the rise of Christianity, you know, Christianity would have only constituted less than 1% of the population of the Roman Empire up until the 3rd century, in which it started growing faster. And then once Constantine adopted it and made it mainstream, then it went faster. So, I mean, I don't really see that Christianity is that shameful. And I also don't necessarily see that, you know, it seems just naturally intuitive and a generally accepted sociological observation that there are people, I think I have given examples of people who were in the society that worshipped angels, believed that, you know, Moses had been, you know, the incarnation of God. People worshipped Enoch as a god, and there were all kinds of crazy Christian cults like the ones that followed Enoch. And then, of course, there were all kinds of Gnostic Christianities and different weird Christianities. I mean, how many different little groups are there? There's so many. And, you know, you think about just how society works. There's always little fringe groups. Sometimes they become popular, like, you know, like Christianity did. And it really was very small until the, I think, 3rd or 4th century.
Well, I agree, it was small, and I think when you get around the time of Porphyry, for instance, and he's pretty much realized, well, yeah, this group is still small, but unfortunately it's here to stay, so we're going to have to learn how to combat it and such. But, I mean, the thing that I'm still saying is, you're talking about beliefs that are seen as wrong, and thinking wrong, therefore, entails shameful. Sometimes it just entails being wrong. These beliefs are incorrect, but they could be seen as still acceptable within society. And if you're talking about people worshiping angels and such, you know, we'd have to see the hard documentation on that and such, because I see people referring to a lot of things that were believed, and unfortunately it's not often as clear cut and dry as that. When we talk about what was shameful about Christianity, I talked about a number of things. Jesus was crucified, big one, huge one. He was not seen as an honorable figure based on his heritage, his reputation, and what he did and didn't do. That Christianity was a new belief, that Christianity was an exclusive belief, that Christianity would cause you to be outcast by your friends and society. And in fact, we could also add in, Christianity held a strict moral code that would not have been required in a lot of other religions. You could have gone and joined a mystery religion very easily in getting the social approval and such you wanted from Christianity. Christianity is putting a bullseye on you.
Well, like, so for example, but I mean, the point of that I'm making with the social outcasting is there's always going to be people who have incredibly shameful beliefs that band together. I mean, take the white supremacist movement in the United States. I mean, at this day and age, especially with Donald Trump out, you know, now we have these people coming forward very strongly, and we realize, sadly, how many there are, and there's a lot. And there's a lot of sympathy to that in the society, even though it's, you know, very, you know, clearly that these, the beliefs they hold are radically, you know, not okay, and they're not, you know, not mainstream at all. So I don't think that, I think that what we see from Christianity, with it being, what is it? It's like 1%, maybe more, maybe a little bit more, up until the 3rd or 4th century.
Well, the thing is that it's still the same thing, like, that there were always people like that, and surely there were some in that society. Where I need to see the data, in fact, as I've argued, there were a lot of people from the upper and middle class that were joining the movement. And I'd also point out that with a lot of these movements, they start out small, but they don't tend to grow as much. They tend to just either stay the same or fade out. This is one reason the whole cognitive dissonance idea fails, because with cognitive dissonance, usually the movement just dies on its own. It doesn't grow much beyond its small band at the start. But Christianity grew and expanded into the people who would have found it the most shameful of all. So, I mean, the same way, I'd say to Carrier, I'd just say, okay, you want to claim these people were here. Go ahead and show where they were. Show specific examples, and no one has.
Well, I'll let you go, but I do want to make two more points before I go. One, I don't necessarily appreciate you lumping me in with Richard Carrier, who I loathe greatly. Okay. And anybody who's a fan of Richard Carrier listening to the cast, I would encourage them to go to Google and see that Richard Carrier is being banned currently from a lot, if not most, of skeptical gatherings due to his just generally bad moral character and actions. The other thing I wanted to say was just the last thing I want to say, because I know Jonathan's already given me a lot of time, but I do think you know, one thing that we might agree on and leave a part on a positive note is that I think I would want to challenge you on whether or not the Roman and Greek citizens who would have been maybe converting to Christianity would have thought that Jesus' crucifixion would have been shameful, because they may not have had that stigma against crucifixion that Jews would. And, you know, I think that another big reason that we have to consider here is that Christianity is also just a very good religion. I am not a 100% Christian by any standards, but I do think it's can possibly be described as the perfection almost of human religion, in the sense that Jesus is just the kind of zenith, pinnacle of exemplar of what a human should be. And I think that there's a dynamism in Christianity that is so strong, with Jesus being such an exemplary individual, but also an extreme focus on unity with God through Christ. And I think that also is extremely appealing.
Well, when we're talking about the citizenship of that first meeting, I would say, and yeah, we can go to the next person after this. I agree with you on Carrier. I was just saying Carrier does make the same kind of argument, unfortunately. But yeah, I agree with you. What he's done is, in many ways, reprehensible and such. But with the how the Romans would have seen it, where here's a quote from Cicero: "How grievous a thing it is to be disgraced by a public court. How grievous to suffer a fine. How grievous to suffer banishment. And yet, in the midst of any such disaster, some trace of our liberty is left to us. Even if we are threatened with death, we may die free men. But the executioner, the veiling of the head, and very word cross should be far removed, not only from a person of a Roman citizen, but from his thoughts, his eyes, and his ears. whereas not only the actual occurrence of these things or the endurance of them, but liability of them, the expectation, nay, the mere mention of them, that is unworthy of a Roman citizen and a free man.
By the way, if I may say, the crucifixion of Jesus became an item of mockery from not just the Jewish side, but also from the Roman side.
Right.
For example, you have a graffiti in Rome where there's a depiction of a crucified donkey and a man staring on in adoration and kneeling before this crucified donkey. And the caption is, Alexandros worships his god. And so there was mockery from the Romans in believing in crucified deity. And then on the Jewish side, if you read, for example, just the martyr's dialogue with the Jewish rabbi, Trypho, in the second century, Trypho says to Justin Martyr, these and such like scriptures, sir, compel us to wait for he who is son of man to receive from the Ancient of Days the everlasting kingdom. But this so-called Christ of yours was dishonorable and inglorious, so much so that the last curse contained in the law of God fell on him, for he was crucified. He also writes towards the end of the dialogue, Trypho says to Justin Martyr, it says, then Trypho remarks, be assured that all our nation waits for Christ, and we admit that all the scriptures which you have quoted refer to him. Moreover, I do also admit that the name of Jesus, by which the son of knave or nun was called, has inclined me very strongly to adopt this view. But whether Christ should be so shamefully crucified, this we are in doubt about. For whosoever is crucified is said in the law to be accursed, so that I am exceedingly incredulous on this point. It is quite clear indeed that the scriptures announce that Christ had to suffer, but we wish to learn, if he can prove it to us, whether it was by the suffering cursed in the law.
Yeah, and I think part of the problem we have in our culture today, Jonathan, is we've become used to Christianity. It's become familiar to us that we read passages saying, oh, yeah, okay. And we don't really pause to think what would have meant to an ancient person to hear Jesus was crucified. It would have been utterly shameful. In fact, the Romans used crucifixion. It was the Phoenicians, I think, who invented it. The Romans used it for this very purpose, shaming. That's why when they went to the Jews in 70 AD and they started cutting down forests so they could cure all the Jews, they used crucifixion, because they wanted to shame them. They wanted them to be an object lesson. And that would have been even to the outcast out there. So are we moving on to the next person, Ben?
Mm-hmm. Just out of curiosity, when you say that you're looking for an example, I mean, I was thinking about what you asked for. You asked for an example of someone that would have been a counterculturalist. Yeah. I'm wondering, what do you mean by you want an example of that? Because I mean, I would think of the people that I described as examples of that.
Well, it's not just counterculture. It'd be people who don't fall into the whole honor shame paradigm. People who don't care anything about honor.
Okay. I see what you're saying.
Yeah.
Gotcha.
And if someone wants to talk about those, good luck finding them.
I'm not necessarily. Yeah, I totally agree with you on that. I see where you're going there.
Well, thank you, Garrett, for calling in. We also had a question from James. So I'll let James come up now. Hey, James.
Yeah, James of all the workout equipment and books nearby. So you're building up your body and your mind both, right?
Right. It's therapy.
Okay.
Hey, can you hear me okay first?
We can hear you.
Yeah, I can. Okay. If I can't hear something, I'll ask for clarification.
Okay, thanks. First question. I think everybody would grant that with the crucifixion as the starting point, Christians would initially encounter some resistance to the idea of Jesus as Messiah, the Savior of the world and everything.
Right.
But regarding the question of the shame of his resurrection body, really, when you look at the resurrection body, if we had the idea of, oh, you're still trapped in a mortal body, you're still going to get old and die even after you've risen from the dead, it's like nobody would worship Lazarus, you know, because we expect Lazarus, after he's raised from the dead, to get old and die again.
Yeah.
In the resurrection body of Jesus, we have something different, something unique, like a theophany.
Right.
And it seems like Jesus' resurrection body has the best of both worlds. We don't see it aging. We see the ability to eat, but also to ascend to heaven and sit at the right hand of God for communication, send the Holy Spirit and inspire. there's really no downside in his resurrection body. That doesn't seem to fit the idea of shame. Wouldn't that be something that would be kind of outside that normal equation?
It could be. And the reason is because resurrection could be seen as a sort of vindication. Of course, someone would have to get to the point of believing, yeah, Jesus was vindicated. I think this is why the Corinthians had a hard time believing in resurrection. See, we often make a mistake. Sometimes I'm thinking when we read 1 Corinthians 15, when Paul starts off with the creed, for instance, and making a case for a resurrection, it's like, well, geez, see, you've even got some Christians here who are doubtful that Jesus has been raised from the dead. No, what Paul is doing is he's making a case from what the Corinthians already accept, and then going on from there, and then saying, what kind of body may be raised up? And he said, no, it won't be this shameful body of flesh and blood and such. It will be a new glorified, honoring body. But you know, you'd have to get to that point with a Greek audience and such, because generally for them, the idea of resurrection would not be seen as a positive. That the idea of maybe an eternal existence could be seen as positive, but I think the Christians did get it right. Go ahead.
Well, it seems like the reason why it wouldn't, you know, carry a lot of weight to a Gentile, to a Greek, would be because of the assumption of mortality.
Right.
You don't see a whole lot of, you know, what if this physical body were immortal?
Yeah.
Whereas when we have Christ's resurrection body, we see somebody who is clearly physical, able to be touched, able to eat, mm-hmm. and yet something different, something unique. Mm-hmm. And our body is going to be like his body. I don't think the typical Gentile would see that as something shameful. He'd say, oh, it's kind of like the best of both worlds.
He could have, but at the same time, some men would have still liked just being free from existence and such. There were different beliefs about the after death, as I prefer to call it. I mean, of course, most of them, the idea of a bodily resurrection would be a bad thing. This was much more of a Jewish concept. And so the person would have to convince the hearer of that. And then you'd also have to get the point of, you know, a lot of people will go around today and say, well, of course Christians were going because they were threatening hell on everyone else and such, and say, well, no, that only works if a threat is seen as real. There would have to be some reason to believe that the resurrection itself was a real deal. And once you believe the resurrection is real, you can look and say, yeah, and I want to get the same position Jesus got. And that's where the crux lies, because for someone of the time, the idea in becoming a Christian was you were identifying with Jesus. Now, identifying with him in his resurrection, that sounds pretty cool and such, but you identified with him in everything. That meant the cross as well. And so you'd be going up to a Roman saying, hey, you see that man, or hear about this man who was on the cross, who was a traitor to Rome? I mean, not that Jesus was preaching treason to Rome, but he would be seen in that way, you know? Because he was crucified, he'd be seen as a traitor to Rome. That man who's a traitor to Rome is an outcast from society. Yeah, I identify with that man. That man is who I'm placing my identity on. Okay, you go and do that. I'm going to go off and do my own way and find a nice religious system that won't put me on the outs of Rome.
Yeah. Okay, yeah, with the idea of Christ being crucified, I think everybody would grant that would be scandalous to the typical Roman mind. At the same time as being able to be a person with the ultimate composure, that would compensate quite a bit, especially in Luke's portrayal of Jesus all during the crucifixion. Mm-hmm. His composure seems to be an emphasis that Luke has, right, that's kind of offset in it. The second point after that first one about the appeal of Jesus' resurrection body was that Christians approaching Gentiles who were kind of like in the back row of the synagogue, the God-fearers, mm-hmm. If they had Isaiah 53 in front of them and accepted it as something worth listening to, that would give the Christians an ability to use that idea of shame as a starting point and then say, well, yes, but look at Israel's history. Look at what God has taught us through Israel's shaming. It was through the destruction of Israel that people were eventually finally spiritually purified. In Isaiah 53, the servant had to go through these things. The shame was a necessary thing, but it was only a transitional thing that ultimately there's glorification involved. And wouldn't that be able to be an effective retort or response, so to speak, to the idea, to the concept of the shame, the scandal, would be followed as the stepping stone by the vindication, by the resurrection, which would start with shame but end in glory. Isn't that kind of a microcosm of the gospel as preached in the Roman Empire?
Hey, I'm wanting to make sure I'm getting you right. Are you saying that people, for instance, could have found the story appealing and then gone on from there? Is that what you're saying?
Well, if you would start with Jesus as when you first meet him, he seems like this teacher, and then he's a miracle worker, and then you have the secret involved. What does he really mean by that kind of thing? And then through the crucifixion, you see his great composure, you see his ability to forgive even under great stress, and then you see his resurrection. Somebody starts with that, and somebody say, well, he was a great guy. Too bad about him being killed. Then we have Isaiah 53 in the picture. And like I said, if you're already a God-fearing kind of Gentile and you respect the prophecy in Isaiah 53, wouldn't Philip's conversation to the Ethiopian eunuch, wouldn't that be able to happen a whole lot and start with the idea of shame, you know, him being pierced and silent before his accusers and all that, but that being used as a platform to say, yes, it was all part of God's plan, But these things had to happen to unfold God's plan for the crucifixion to happen, as you know, the Passover Lamb of God and all that.
Yeah.
But the shame, I think, would be easy for a thoughtful Christian to use as a platform for this point about vindication, about glorification later on, being able to say to the typical Gentile who doesn't like the idea of physicality, to use that as a trampling to the point that the physical crucifixion is a transition to eternal glorification. Well, what happened to Jesus can happen to you.
Yeah, but I think what would something I could stress is that, you know, really, the Christians would have loved to have left out the crucifixion. One reason I want to stress this is because the Christians, in their eyes, they weren't making this stuff up. This was stuff they were saying really did happen at one point in time. And yes, they would eventually want to get to the resurrection, but getting past the crucifixion, why it happened, what kind of person would have something like that happen to them, that would be a hard sell at that point. Now, to a God-fearer, maybe you could point to a passage like Isaiah 53 and such, and maybe then you could show that Jesus was resurrected and thus was vindicated, but then you'd have to have some reason to think he was really resurrected. I think that's where the minimal facts approach comes in. Much more in that case, where you can start looking and saying, well, yeah, he was resurrected. We know this because so many people saw him and such. And when you hear that he was resurrected, you establish that, and the person looks and says, yeah, Jesus died a shame for death, but he was vindicated. That meant that God honored him. And see, we're still in the honor-shame paradigm then, because the person look and say, and the honor of God ranks above the honor of men. I mean, this is what you have going on, and I believe it's John 12, where there are so many people who want to follow Jesus, but John says they didn't because they wanted the praise of men rather than the praise of God. And so, again, what I'm saying is that, of course, Jesus could be seen as honorable at the end, but you would have to overcome the shame, and you would have to be convinced he was resurrected. Other than that, someone could just go and look and say, oh, that's a good story. Okay, I'm going to go off and worship Zeus now. I mean, a lot of people today can even look and say, okay, well, Christianity might have a good story, but I have no reason to believe it. And so Christians would have to do both. And my contention is just that the honor-shame paradigm, with it in play, Christians had a whole lot of hurdles to overcome. And yet they did. The fact that the belief did grow show that people did believe Jesus had been vindicated by God. Does that help?
Yeah, somewhat. I had one more question, and then I'll let somebody else in. The idea of Jesus and his shame, or the scandal of the cross, we see Christianity kind of trickling into Roman society and culture from the bottom up. It's kind of a grassroots thing at first. We don't see until Constantine. But wouldn't that give a certain appeal to the typical underclass person in Roman society to say, "Hey, Jesus, the great Son of God, pre-incarnate, lowered himself, shamed himself, emptied himself, and came down here to us. He's one of us. Look at his death. He was shameful like us." Paradoxically, to Christians who are not in the high, dignified, aristocratic class of Rome, in other words, you know, the most of them, couldn't this be framed as a positive thing? Shameful, like you, Ralph, shameful. Because they don't have a whole lot of social influence. They're subject to Rome. They don't have the class. They're the underdog. Couldn't that be presented as, you know, when the underdog wins, the people still cheer because he's the underdog. Couldn't that have an apologetic force in the early Roman Empire, at least in the first two centuries?
I think that could be reading too much about cultural entry, about the cheering for the underdog and such. When we're talking about the idea of where this wouldn't have been seen as shame for them because, you know, Jesus had become one of us, I'd really have to see it, because even then they would have known their position was shameful and not wanting to give it. And when we look at the crucifixion was sending a message to the people who were the most shameful of lives, and it was meant to be applied to people who were shameful, not the elite. The elite got death sentences, like, say, and such. But crucifixion was sending a message, in fact, to those who were not elite and saying, don't be like this guy. It would put yourself in fervor out.
Yeah, but when the Christians present the Gospels, I don't think it ever stops at just the cross.
It doesn't stop at the cross. The thing is, it takes a whole lot of thinking about kind of presentation to get past the cross. There has to be something really huge, some really big reason to think the shame portion was overcome. It's easy to believe Jesus was crucified. That would have been something in very public record. It's not as easy to believe he was resurrected. And that's even so today. Today, you'll find many people who have no problem believing Jesus was crucified. That resurrection is still a problem.
By the way, on that point, C.S. Lewis refers to what he calls chronological snobbery, where we basically retroject a modern view, a modern paradigm back into the ancient world, or consider ourselves far more advanced than those superstitious know-nothings in the ancient world. And of course, in the ancient world, we tend to think everyone believed in resurrections, and everyone had an uncle who'd been raised from the dead, and so on. But if you actually read the literature, it turns out that that's far from the case. For example, Theophilus of Antioch in the second century wrote a letter to the pagan Autolycus, and in his apology to Autolycus, he says, "Now, as to your saying that the dead are not raised, for he says, show us even one who's been raised from the dead, that seeing we may believe." So obviously there was skepticism in the ancient world about resurrection, albeit for different reasons than we have today. There was skepticism in the Jewish world because the Jews weren't expecting a dying, much less a rising Messiah. The Pharisees believed in a general resurrection at the end of the world. The Sadducees didn't believe in any resurrection at all. And in any case, the type of resurrection that Jesus was, according to the Gospels, is quite unlike what you would expect from a Jewish paradigm. For example, the key text in Second Temple Judaism concerning resurrection is Daniel 12, where the righteous are shining like stars at the point at the time of the resurrection, whereas no one ever thinks to portray Jesus as shining like a star. The type of resurrection that Jesus experiences is quite unlike what you would expect from a Jewish perspective. Moreover, if you read Justin Martyr in his first apology, when he's writing to the Romans, this is a Roman audience that he's writing to, and in chapter 19, it's a title in chapter entitled "The Resurrection Possible." He says, "And to any thoughtful person, would anything appear more incredible than if we were not in the body, and someone were to say that it was possible that from a small drop of human seed, bones and sinews and flesh be formed into a shape such as we see? For let this now be said hypothetically: if you yourselves were not such as you now are, and born of such parents and causes, and one were to show you human seed in a picture of a man, and were to say with confidence that from such a substance, such a being can be produced, would you believe before you saw the actual production? No one will dare to deny that such a statement would surpass belief. In the same way, then, you are now incredulous because you have never seen a dead man rise again. But as at first you would have not have believed it possible that such persons could be produced from a small drop, and yet now you see them thus produced, so also judge ye that it is not impossible that the bodies of men, after they have been dissolved and like seeds resolved into earth, should in God's appointed time rise again and put on incorruption. And so he's writing there to the Roman audience and basically saying, you guys think it's incredulous that someone could rise from the dead. And he's trying to persuade them that that's not the case. And then in the Jewish world, no one was expecting someone to rise to glory and immortality prior to the general resurrection at the end of the world. So the resurrection seems to take everyone completely by surprise. And this is very evident even from the internal evidence in the Gospels, our Gospel accounts. For example, in John's account, when they discover the empty tomb, it says they still had not realized from Scripture that God is to raise Jesus from the dead. In Luke's account, when the women report the empty tomb, it says the first they didn't believe the woman, for it seemed to them like nonsense. And you find the resurrection narratives are very simple. They are completely devoid of theological reflection. They don't draw on the Old Testament Scriptures. They are completely lacking in the rich arsenal of prophetic texts that characterize the rest of the Gospels, in particular Matthew. Mm-hmm. So that seems to be to me to be fascinating.
Well, maybe Luke 24, the discussion with Flappers, it's summarized, but clearly Jesus is appealing to the Scriptures when he talks about how the law and the Psalms and the prophets had to be fulfilled.
Yeah, well, you can say that, sure. But first of all, I could say something about what Matthew, or what John can say, I'm thinking about Matthew McCormick there. Because he's written the same kind of thing about the chronological snobbery. I've just had to read his book for someone, and you know, he says, you know, resurrection back then, that would have just seemed like common sense and such. Well, no, it wouldn't. I actually call the chronological snobbery argument, I'll refer to it as ancient people were stupid. Because that's usually the viewpoint that's presented. A lot of people say, well, these people didn't even know about modern science and such. Well, that they might have had less knowledge about war, but it doesn't mean they were stupid. It's not as if you say, oh, well, you know the earth goes around the sun, where automatically you're educated, you're a smart person then. No, it just means you have a common knowledge of the day. It doesn't mean you're brilliant, because chances are most of us don't even know how that's reached a lot of the times and such. We can't defend it, we just know it. Now, with the Luke 24, I agree with what Jonathan said. It's amazing how the Gospels lack a whole lot of theological input at the end. When we see the sermon in Luke, as where Luke 24 is, he opens his mind and says, and here's how everything written about me in the law, the prophets, and the Psalms has been fulfilled. And he talks to Cleopas and his companion and gives a whole talk about how he fulfilled everything. How wonderful it would have been to be a fly on the proverbial wall at that point. The thing is, we don't have a single word of that conversation except for at the end where we have the whole thing of, you know, you want to stay here. No, I mean, you know, no, please stay here. And when our hearts burning within us as he walked along with us, we don't know what Jesus said was fulfillment. We'd love to, but we don't. Now, if this was kind of thing that was being made up later on, we would expect to see a whole lot of things being said, a whole lot of text being referred to, but we don't.
Yeah, that might be Luke writing a book and realizing that this book's going to be used not just by one person, but by more people. And he's giving his book readers a platform to say to, probably that he would naturally take it for granted, there's a Christian somewhere around, and the reader who's not a believer yet can say, the law, the prophets, and the Psalms that he mentions, it's all summarized here. Tell me more. So that's just a platform. That doesn't mean that there's nothing there. Clearly there's oodles in that being referred to. It's just going to naturally provoke that question. Tell me more about the law, the Psalms, and the prophets that tell about Jesus.
Yeah, one of the reasons I think for that also is another aspect of the world of a time. It was what was called a high context society. We live today in a low-context society where you hear a nation about a a story on the news about a bombing taking place in a city, and you say, this city is the capital of so-and-so. Why? Because they think most viewers out there don't know that kind of thing. They have to explain a whole lot more to you. I remember when I was reading the Federalist Papers, for instance, they would talk about all these Greek battles that took place and such, and they never explained what happened in these battles. It was like the author thought, you already know what happened in these battles, I don't need to go into it. Now, when we read the epistles, for instance, of Paul, a lot of people look and say, why isn't Paul talking about all these events in the life of Jesus and such? Well, he's not, because that would have been part of the oral tradition. It would have been the background knowledge that the readers were assumed to have, and Paul's not going to spend any time talking about it. Besides, one thing, writing was very, very expensive. By our standards today, just writing the book of Galatians, for instance, would cost about $500. How much money you got in your wallet? And that's not even counting just delivery and things of that sort. The writing was very expensive. If you want the reference on that, it's like a Rediscovering Paul by Rodney Reeves, Randy Richards, and David Capes. Writing was extremely expensive, and secretaries charged by the line for material, time, everything else.
Okay, with that noted, I doubt that it would have been the equivalent of $500 to write Galatians on papyrus. Jonathan, I think that's all three of my questions there, so back to you.
All right. Thank you. Okay, do we have any other questions from anyone? If you have any questions, then raise your hand or submit them via the Q&A box. Otherwise, we will begin to wrap up. Going once, going twice. Okay, Nick, do you want to give you the address again for your website and how people can maybe learn more about your work and get a hold of you?
I just had a certain feeling like I was a contestant on Sale of a Century. I'm a game show junkie, okay? But my website, http://deeperwaters.dbns.net. And if people want to get in touch with me, my email is, where you can see my, can everyone see my name, Apologia Nick, up there?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, just put @gmail.com after that. And you can find me on Facebook also. Nick Peters, Deeper Waters, also has a webpage. And the Deeper Waters podcast as well. I mean, I encourage you, listen to Jonathan's show live or recording such, but please take some time to listen to the Deeper Waters podcast as well. And if you like it, try and leave a positive review. I really love seeing the reviews and such. It's very honoring to see all the reviews and such. And I just encourage people, read a lot more about the whole honor shame perspective, some great works on this. Randolph Richards and Brandon O'Brien have a book, Misreading Scripture with Western Eyes. Warner Mischke's book, The Global Gospel. David DeSilva's Honor, Patronage, Kinship, Purity. All of these books, the whole thing really, in the New Testament, the Old Testament, they're wonderful books as they are, but reading them from honor and shame opens up a whole new world of the gospel, and so much more makes sense that wouldn't have made sense before.
Yeah, and if you want to check out my website, it's apologetics-academy.org. If you click on online apologetics training, it will take you to the schedule for upcoming webinars. So just enter that URL into the chat window there. So apologetics-academy.org/online-training will take you straight to the schedule for upcoming webinars. You'll notice that next week we have Sir Anthony Buzzard on with us, who is a biblical Unitarian, and he's going to talk to us about why he's a biblical Unitarian and why he doesn't affirm the deity of Christ. Mm. Vladimir Suzuki is saying, don't go to John's website, it's a full of things that will break your Islamic faith. Well, that is true, but All right. Well, thank you, Nick, for coming on. And I look forward to seeing you guys all again next week.